Hello, this is Andrew Brooks. Another presentation of Non-Linear Existentialism, Similarities with Bergson's work, Creative Evolution, subtitled The Question of Human Creativity. The gist of this presentation is seeing the similarities between Non-Linear Existentialism and the work of Henri Bergson, Creative Evolution. The key ideas, I believe, are very similar, and there's just going to be a few that are slightly different. The main reason is that he, although mentions quite a bit about the biological substrate, sometimes he wavers between the mechanism and the concepts that are produced by them. So the question of human creativity. Non-linear existentialism claims creativity is a natural byproduct of processing multi-sensory input. With the essay entitled Creative Evolution, written by Henri Bergson, making a similar claims, but for apparently different reasons. The two works may share similar reasoning, but with different terminology. Or perhaps there's going to be some theories within either one of them that don't per se 100% agree, but they come to a similar conclusion. So I won't read all the quotation. As before, I don't like to paraphrase. I basically write down what's in the work, and let the audience look at it to decide whether or not the interpretation I give it is correct or not. But basically, in the introduction of a Creative Evolution, Bergson talks about the two ways in which perhaps evolutionary pressures can be exhibited within a biological mechanism, the two of which is going to be mechanism and finality. In the context of artificial intelligence, we're looking at top-down or bottom-up. Bottom-up would be the mechanism, and finality would be the top-down. And what he says in that is that neither one of them is good enough. However, but as he says in the red ones that are emphasized throughout in red, but that one of them might be recut and resown, and in this new form fit less badly than the other. And through the quotations I'll be giving you, he goes more towards the idea of finality. Mechanism to him, which would be bottom up, he thinks is too restrictive. So radical mechanism and radical finalism, basically the two is the idea of all is given. Both of them have the idea of radical mechanism is that the beginning processes push the outcome forward, and so it's restrictive. And for radical finalism is basically the end goal is going to be, again, restricting it. And in red here is, but duration, the truth is that we change without ceasing, and that the state itself is nothing but change. This is number two under section duration, something from this for our consciousness, that is to say for that which is most indisputable. So for him, duration, which is change, cannot be determined, cannot be defined, cannot be properly described if you go into the idea of final, radical finalism. So he said that mechanism and finalism aren't sufficient, aren't good enough, especially with the idea of his duration being that of change. So please read your quotation in full, but this is the gist of his argument. So again, with radical finalism, the doctrine of teleologically in its extreme form, as we find Libernetz, for example, implies that things and beings merely realize a program previously arranged. And then further down, as in the mechanism theory here, again, it is supposed that all is given. Again, you think that if there's the idea of creativity, if you're restrictive either at the beginning mechanism or at the end finalism, you cannot have creativity. So further, another quotation at the bottom, but there is, we are told, an internal finality. Each being is made for itself, all of its parts conspire for the greatest good of the whole and are intelligibly organized in view of that end. He does not like the idea of internal finality, as we'll see in the next quotation. You'll see at the bottom here, the idea of a finality that is always internal is therefore a self-destructive notion. Doesn't mean per se that he doesn't believe internal finalism is possible, but again he says always internal is therefore a self-destructive notion. His view when he was looking at biological mechanisms, the cell and such, you gotta realize this was written in 1911, that they came up with the idea of cell theory and took it further, that was saying that because the body is composed of many, many, many cells, that he was looking at a very constrictive idea that each cell, if it goes to its own end, that's an internal. But as mentioned in Non-Linear Existentialism, we go to the idea of a more expressive internal finalism, if you want to use that term, but again, it's very non-specific. What appears in his ideas is that he believes in the idea of internal, but he can't understand it well enough that he goes to more towards the idea of an external finalism. But I believe, as you will see throughout this presentation, that internal finalism is possible, but again, expressing the external finality, which is going to be towards the idea of energy. So here again, but the position of vitalism is rendered very difficult by the fact that in nature there is neither purely internal finality or absolutely distinct individuality. This is kind of his driving idea, is that he does believe in finalism, but he can't go to the idea of a restrictive idea. That's where he goes to a vital principle or vital inductive principle that pushes things forwards. But again, it's more of a, and I will try to make this argument later on, that the vital principle is more of an expression of external energy being internalized in the primary needs baseline activity level that's been mentioned many other times in these presentations. And he has its vital principle, but it's kind of like non-specific idea. And so it's very much like a finalism, but the thing is that it's going to be a non-specific finalism. And he expresses the idea of more of it being external, internalized, but still external being more important. So quotations, further quotations from his work. Development of animal life, the role of life is to insert some interdetermination in the matter, and that's near to dear to the work of non-linear existentialism, of course, because it is expressing the idea of being non-determinate. Intelligence and instinct, another important idea with his, is that he talks about intelligence and instinct, and the quote at the very bottom is very important: instinct perfected his faculty of using constructing organized instruments. Intelligence is perfected as a faculty of making and using unorganized instruments. So for him, instinct is what the individual is born into the earth with. He has an instinct, automated ability to do certain things. So the thing is that it's an organized, that he able to use organized instrument. It's automated. Intelligence is the ability to make instruments. So intelligent instinct, for every need that's satisfied, it intelligent creates a new need. And so instead of closing like instinct the round of action within which the animal tends to move automatically, it lays open, that is intelligence, to activity, an unlimited field into which it is driven further and further and made more and more free. This is very much like non-linear existentialism, but for him there's a big gap between instinct, which is automated and defined and restricted, and intelligence, which is open to the idea of making new ideas. And later on we'll see he has that term that he's trying to bridge between instinct and intelligence. And I think it's very much like non-linear existentialism. And what's really important is this idea of disorder. We had in a previous presentation the idea of entropy, but again it was expressed the idea of order, internal order and external order. Both are ordered, but when one is viewed against another one, it can seem to be disorder, and I use the idea of entropy. So this is a very important quote and a very important idea. Now suppose that there are two species of order, and that these two orders are two contraries within one and the same genus. And when one is in comparison to the other, it appears to be disorder, but each is actually order, which is a very important idea, and the thing that shows how similar the two different theories are. So further with this one, he talks about trying to figure out how to express the idea of disorder. And for him, he goes to the idea of geometrical mechanism, going towards the idea of one order, and a second type of order is going to be more of the idea of finality. It's more expressive, more open. But again, he doesn't go into the idea of why they might seem like that to each other, but I think these are very, very much similar to non-linear existentialism idea of restrictive and non-so-restrictive. Perhaps the intelligent would be seen of the idea of a geometrical mechanism, or that which allows intelligence to be produced, and the other one, which is going to be more automated, is going to be the other type of order. Again, I think the ideas are very similar, and please read the quotations on this. Laws in genera, vital, the idea of the vital driving mechanism, vital that we have appear to do, and the whole present science strives to prove that the vital is in the direction of the voluntary, which is again extremely similar to that being mentioned in non-linear existentialism, that the vital, in this case, the vital drive, it allows the automated system instinct to allow to voluntary, and for voluntary, I believe it's very much the idea of being able to be non-linear with the environment. So what he's basically saying is that the vital induction, the vital energy, or vital, I shouldn't use the word, vital power that goes through or allows for evolution is going towards automated to freedom to creativity, very much like non-linear existentialism. And for here he has for the Kantian criticism in red, there would be, in other words, a super intellectual intuition. In this case, he's trying to bridge between the instinct, which is automated, and intelligence. The idea is what allows that to occur, the bridging between the two. And again, this is very similar to the idea of the modulation frequency and amplitude modulation that occurs in non-linear existentialism. The freedom, the variance that is created by non-linear existentialism and the modulation of it would allow this to occur. So again, from the conceptual point of view, we're very close, but again, it doesn't really bring forth a biological possibility to process that would allow it to occur. So further on this one, just going to what we talked about before, and please read the quotations. But again, it's very, very much like we was talking about before. He's coming with conceptual, but it's very hard for him to bridge the gap between a biological process and the concept. In the middle quotation here, we'll see as there is indeed no intuition that carries us into non-temporal. For him, non-temporal means without the physical. All intuition is thus found to be sensuous by definition. I would argue against him because this is, I think, one of the keys to his inability to perhaps see that the addition of variable of uncertainty is the key facet here. Whenever he gets into that idea, the ability to have creation, he goes believing that it is metaphysical, and him metaphysical means non-biological, and he won't allow himself to do this one. So he almost makes the idea that the idea of being metaphysical is beyond the scope of his argument. So again, he's saying all intuition is thus found to be sensuous by definition. So if you go on the idea of a super intuition, it therefore would have to be, by extension, also sensuous. But I've argued many times that it can be from the physical, but because of the idea of the inclusion of variance, that it can be sensual. It can be bound. It can be originally from the intuition, because the intuition is going to be, in this case, the biological. And through adding variance movement in neuronal tissue, it allows for the variance to be in there, but it's still from the body. But the thing is that it is not sensual per se, because it's non-linear to it. So the overview of creative evolution, the vital impulsion, that's key to him toward the voluntary, toward creation, and his non-specific finalism. But again, he doesn't go into the idea of further what does that mean. And it's not due to relations between sensory inputs, concepts. So again, he is saying that it isn't concept driven, it is more of a force and more sort of a drive that allows for evolution to go forward, but he doesn't know how to express it in biological terms. Duration, continual change is very important to his work. Mechanism and finalism, we've talked about this, and the idea of the difference between instinct and intellect. Instinct is organized instruments that are already there, and they're sensuous. They're from the body as they were born into its life. And intellect is unorganized instruments. It is vast. It is the ability to recreate based on the instinct carried forward. The idea of order and disorder, very, very important. And then the super intellectual intuition, which I believe is a gap between the instinct and the intellect. Before going further, we're going to go with the idea of that's mentioned in the Charities of Life website, transfer of energy within the environment and effects of such interactions on the development of humanity, and that's in Charities of Life website. The idea of energy, which is what allows all this to occur, this is a non-specific way to develop. It's there, the outcomes of it are not predetermined, it just causes the possibility of change, and change within the elements, within the environment, can determine what they are going to do as an outcome without actually having a goal. So energy, that which causes a change in the medium or object within the medium. Response, this is short-term response. The mediums and or objects' immediate response to the energy will be dependent on how responsive the medium and or object is to that level of energy. It's immediate response, and this is where it gets important. Change, the length of time an object is changed by an energy source is dependent on the object's ability to absorb the energy without disrupting the object's ability to function. So you can say that you've got an object that has originally been in contact with an energy source, and its immediate response is going to be different from its long term. You can make the argument between organic and inorganic here. Inorganic would be the rock. It has an energy source that impacts against it. It responds not in the same way that maybe an organic material would, and because the organic material is going to be more sensitive to being more able to be changed than over a long term, that the energy source can cause it to alter, and through the alteration, as opposed to a rock, it can in perhaps go from order, which is order as it is associated with the environment. If it's in agreement with the environment, it'd be order, and after a period of time, the organic material can go towards disorder, where it would actually not be flowing in the manner that the energy source would cause it to do without it being coalesced together, and possibly leading to it being removed from the environment, as in being able to carry out operations that might be against the order that's expressed in the environment. So outcome in teleology, energy, physical force, electromagnetic, radiation, gravity, etc. may interact with an environment and those objects within it, leading to a specific outcome, but this does not mean that the specific outcome was the intent of the energy. Intent, as you will see in here, is a requirement for a specific goal. For there to be a purpose and or goal in an action, there has to be intent in that which is creating the action, energy. I have capital E here as going to be the energy that's created by the environment, by non-anthropomorphic energy. The sun, gravity, elements like that, they just express themselves to even physicochemical properties of the element. It just does what it does because it's naturally made in that way. It does it without a goal. If the object affecting energy or is affecting others with the energy is producing a result only through passive means, one domino hitting another, then there is no purpose. It is just doing, expressing its own nature. With intent being a byproduct of choice, and since choice can be produced by separation from the object from the environment, remove the environment as a controlling agent, this causes object to become non-linear with the environment, possibly leading to disorder. Again, it was mentioned going from the idea of leading, following the path that the energy source would lead it to, and then through further and further change because of that interaction, disorder can actually be produced. Disorder meaning the order within the object can be against the order of the environment. And through this, there's no intent in the entire process. It expresses that way because through coalescing of the materials together, organic materials together, as we've been shown in non-linear existentialism, it can create emergence of disorder, can occur, and that disorder is actually the interference that has been argued, interference of the internal modulating agents within the human telencephalon to the input that they go towards it, and that would express the personality and the ability to rally against the environment in some manner. So initially non-complex objects interacted with energy and were passively altered by the interaction. With time, more complex objects have been produced, composed of changeable elements, organic, which allowed them to be less passive in their reaction to energy. So planets would be considered less passive. They've got some reaction against the environment. They're not completely in disorder, but they're not as ordered towards the environment because they express themselves against the environment in some way. With more development, some objects have become composed of readily changeable materials, organic, able to free themselves of their direct neuronal binding through frequency modulation, the idea of time, connection with the environment, plants to animals. Such creatures were able to formulate simple goals. Further, and this is probably one of the more important slides, with more development, the sensory processing areas, telencephalon of some advanced animals, man, have become even more non-linear with the sensory input. So frequency modulation, frequency and amplitude. These are going to be the two modulations. So you got frequency, which is time, amplitude, which is the interference, allowing the individual, which is a byproduct of this process, to formulate, create, and produce complex goals. And these complex goals would be, or could be, against the environment. So this would be the idea of disorder expressed. Outcome and teleologically, one more. Therefore, although energy from nature is the driving or primary reason, vital impulsion for development, without energy being emitted in a pattern by an object with a specific goal, teleology or the purpose ends is not present. Internal teleology is possible. It would be to a level of energy and not to a concept. So energy, external energy, once brought inside and to a specific level, the idea of the primary needs baseline activity level, that's the internalized energy from the outside, and the entire system is going towards re-reaching that energy level. But it doesn't mean that the thing is that there's a conceptual impulsion. It's going to be more of a biological process driven. The concepts come afterwards. The outcomes of a naturally emitted energy without intelligent intercession is driven by chance. The emergence of non-linear entities within an environment has and can continue to occur without calling upon external finality and anthropomorphic higher power. So just the attributes of non-linear existentialism. These have been mentioned throughout. So the process, non-linear existentialism, first and foremost, is an energy-driven process, biological process, that is occurring because of the shift between order and order to order to disorder. So the process, physical mechanism, energetics, not concept, abstract driven. Concepts are used to reduce uncertainty, not to create certainty. So the thing is that the concepts that are associated with the energy states within the mind are an afterward. They occur by association. And the thing is that they allow the person who forms from it to perhaps understand how the energy states are associated, but they themselves are a secondary aspect. So pattern recognition, we got the frequency modulation and amplitude modulation. Positive feedback regulation of energetics. This is very important. And this goes to the idea of having displacement away from the primary needs baseline activity level and bring it towards itself again. And this has been expressed many times. And at the bottom here is residual inconsistency going to zero. This is the non-specific internal teleology. Basically, the idea is that non-specific is not meaning patterns. It is that going towards a the original internal energy state. Again, the internal is the expression of the external energy state. So the bottom here is kind of the gist of the entire presentation. The vital impetus as a process, internal non-specific mechanisms created by energy, internal non-specific finality. Vital impetus as a concept as opposed to the process, internal specific patterns associated with internal non-specific mechanism is created by experience, external specific energy patterns which become internal specific patterns. So whenever we have anything that's specific, that's the idea of a pattern. So you first have the process occurring before the concept, and a lot of times philosophers seem to, they do mention that we are biological beings, and but most of the time they seem to argue towards the concept, not realizing the process, that which allows for the concept to be produced is primary, and they seem to kind of mix and match the two, and it kind of leads to some frustration. So going back to Bergson's instinct and intelligence, I believe that within the context of this presentation, instinct is automated, and then you have time, amplitude, modulation, then you have intellectual animal, and then you go to the super intellectual instinct, and then, which is going to be the frequency modulation, and then you lead to the intellectual. So you can see how go from instinct to the intellectual, the bridging agent of the super intelligible instinct. And all the red ones are going to be what Bergson was expressing in his work. And I've just filled it in with the non-linear existentialisms to see how, if you take the two together, how the two can be understood in this larger context. So you go from something that's automatic, that which is given, which is kind of more of a mechanism, towards the intellectual, the human intellectual ability to make instruments throughout their lifetime. And then we also have the idea of amplitude modulation and frequency modulation, and these seem to be very close to his ideas. But again, we're going the idea of how we have the vital impulse, and the vital impulse throughout this entire is energy of that, the driving energy through development of the biological mechanism, which is us, and how it allows through the order to disorder being expressed throughout. As per the dictates of adaptation, each new level of development is a result of changes to the previous level. So this is what I was trying to also show, that through this process, the first one, instinct to super intellectual, instinct to intelligence, is it can occur through adaptation, and we can just jump from one to another and not show how that occurs. So each level of development is also an increase in disorder. As per the self-line function, the human intellect can decrease but also increase the disorder. So if it is working correctly, we go towards the idea of instinct, towards having time and amplitude modulation, which can create a little bit of interference. But as you go further up, we go from the intellectual animal to the intellectual human, and that's going to be between the two is going to be the super intellectual instinct, Bergson's, and that's going to be a big thrust of disorder. Order within, but disorder as it compared to the environment. And hopefully through this, as mentioned in self-lying function, that through connecting with others in the environment and learning what the previous residual incongruencies within a person's patterns are, we can go towards the idea of disorder. But it isn't natural unless the individual has developed property that will allow them to understand, or also the society into which they are. So the conclusion, the theories postulated by Henri Bergson in The Creative Evolution are very similar to those offered in the works describing non-linear existentialism. However, due to the former work treating concepts, patterns associated with non-specific mechanism, and quantifying process non-specific mechanism as equivalents, this may not allowed Bergson to consider the full fully realized super-intellectual intuition as being both non-intuition and a result of eternal finalism. As with many philosophers, by mixing the unique attributes of the biological mechanism and the patterns that are associated with them, it makes it difficult for the author to make firmer decision conclusions. So this is mentioned throughout that he does say many times about the biological mechanism, and when he was discussing the eye, he was going, well, there's going to be some vital impulsion within it that allow the eye to be expressed in very similar ways throughout very different evolutionary lines. I agree completely with that. But that is a biological mechanism, pure and simple. There's no concepts per se that are associated with that. And if he made that argument and carried it further, perhaps you'd be less confused between the ideas of the mechanism and the concepts. The brain per se, as I've been mentioned many times, it makes patterns, and that's why it actually is developed in the way it is, and why there's so many confusion perhaps with it, because there is so much uncertainty within it. We're trying to get the concepts to be in agreement with each other, but they're made after the biological mechanism and the feedback loops that describe it. So there is confusion when you discuss the concepts as being the leading idea, whereas the biological mechanism is more important. Thank you very much for your time. I know there's a lot of information here, but I thought it was very important to show this presentation as it is. And please read many quotations that I've made. There's a lot of information. I thank you very much for your time. Take care.